well known personality in this field. She has not only the marathon service, that is the 36 years she has worked as a teacher as well as the scientist. And presently he is holding the chair of head department of botany at Vazhinjan College, Mulund, Mumbai. Her specialization spectrum is plant tissue culture, animal cell culture, algal biotechnology, and herbal cosmetics. And furthermore, I will take the privilege to tell you that association of Dr. Mrs. Devdar with the Dr. Balasaheb Sawant Kokan Krishi Vidyapeeth, it goes down to 25 years, if I am not wrong, when Dr. Dhonukshi was there. Am I correct, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So she has done the very beautiful work as I have told you, in the different area of specialization. And as everybody knows, the tissue culture is art. And definitely, for any surgery or for any drawing, it needs the skillful fingers. It's a job of the fine finger. So today we will come to know what is the magic of this fine finger she has done in her current past and what she is going to do in the immediate future. So I think with this introduction, the student will come to know that she is having very vast experience. Even I forget to tell you one thing, she has been associated with the different funding agencies like NBPJR, then DBT, UGC, NCC, BM, and furthermore, to her credit, there are the 18 PhD students she has guided, and for the 50 students, she has enacted as a MSc chairman. So she is having the vast experience, and she has done the very beautiful work in this particular area. Even she has acted as a lead presenter in Germany, Amsterdam, Singapore, and Malaysia. So we are fortunate enough that the expert orator will listen today. So madam, please, you can continue with your lectures. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for a nice introduction. The topic today is very dear to me, that is role of agronomist in clonal propagation and quality control of essential oil yielding plants. I am Dr. Mrs. Devdar, belonging to the V.G. Vazhe College for last 36 years. And to introduce that this college is founded by a great perfumist, Mr. G.D. Kelkar. Yes. And we had, can you hear me?
Yes,
all of you?
Yes.
And we had a good contact, good association with Mr. G.D. Kelkar. And we have learned many things in the perfumery, in the agronomy of oil yielding, essential oil yielding plants from him. So I have pleasure to present myself to the agriculturist, to my experiences to the agriculturist, so that they will come to know more details about the cultivation of essential oil yielding plants. So before we go to the quality control of essential oil yielding plants, first we will see how the best clones are identified in essential plants. And before we go to that, we will learn what are essential oils. So first few slides, I will be engaging you in the introduction of essential oils. So we use aromatic plants or aroma compounds from dawn to dusk. So as we wake up, our toothpaste is nothing but the mint. So tea, we add many spices, we add ginger, etc., dried ginger, lemongrass. So that is another example. While preparing our breakfast, again we come across many spices. While taking bath, again many aroma compounds we use: rose, then santalum, etc. While puja, many fragrant chemicals we use. And at night also, good night is containing the aroma compounds. So from dawn to dusk, we have to be associated with the aroma compounds. Then we are also associated with the aroma compounds from our birth to death, from cradle to coffin. Then in every moment, we are associated with the aroma compounds, that is in happiness, in romance, in worship, in peace, and in sorrow. So in every mood of us, we are associated with the aroma compounds. Then this association of aroma compounds is last. There are many proofs in history that we were associated with the aroma compounds right from beginning, right from the ancient civilizations. We were associated with the aroma compounds. Egyptians, they used aroma compounds in mummies. They kept the aroma compounds in mummies. Then these aroma compounds or infusions were extensively used by the Egyptians and by the Chinese people to embalm themselves at the time of rituals. They used these aroma compounds. Then herbal baths, they used to use many aroma compounds. And they have understood what are the benefits, health benefits of these aroma compounds. So right along with the embalming with the aroma compounds, they have also used that these aroma, when we use that aroma, when they use these aroma compounds, they were really calming, tranquilizing, then sleep inducing, mood elevating, etc. So that was known right from the beginning, and till now also it is used for aroma. This is called nothing but the aroma therapy. So herbal baths were in herbal baths they were used like this for to dilate blood vessels, to slow down the heart race, means to relieve tension, means calming. So they were using this right from the ancient days. So there are some pictures how in the primitive ages the aroma compounds they were used. Now this was in ancient days. So as I have told you earlier, right from beginning, they were used as tranquilizers, then stress busters, sleep inducers, etc. So all these things nowadays, they are again used in the aroma. So pharmaceutical applications. So pharmaceutical applications, first is aromatherapy. So all these cinnamomum or lavender, they are stress busters. So in aromatherapy, or nowadays they are used in insecticides or pesticides, for example, citronella, mosquito repellents, etc. Then antimicrobial, they have good antimicrobial activity. So they are used in floor cleaners, hand sanitizers, etc. Then many of them, they are known to be antioxidants. And nowadays there is a customary to replace the chemical preservatives like methyl paraben. And many of these aroma compounds, for example, rosemary oil is used in place of methyl paraben as the antioxidant, antibacterial, etc. So you know now the importance of tulsi, piper, cinnamomum in the antiviral. Nowadays all these have got importance. So anti-inflammatory, for example, haldi. So they have, apart from the apart from their role in enhancing the aroma, they have lot many roles in pharmaceutical industries. So these are some of the roles in pharmaceutical industries. Now going to the essential oil yielding plants. Now first we go to the role of essential oils to the plants. We will go how this word is derived from essential oil. When I was doing the orientation course, right, very in the beginning, suppose 30 years back, I was doing one, we have to do orientation refresher courses, and I had to talk for 10 minutes. Then I have chosen this topic, essential oil. Then I have told all these things, and the in orientation course, there were the people from various areas, not only the science. There were economics, there were commerce people. And after telling all these things about the aroma compounds, they asked me why this is called as essential oil. We thought that you will be talking something about the petrol and diesel, because that is the that is in for commerce people, they are essential oils. But how the you then I have understood, they have not realized what is the meaning of essential oil. The word essential comes from essence, word essence. What is the meaning of essence? We heat it at very low temperature, they are evaporated. So these compounds, they are called essence at low boiling fractions. They are called essence. And hence these compounds, they are called essential. Means it is, we should not pronounce it as essential, but we should pronounce it as essential. So essential oil, how we will first see essential oils, where in which different plant parts they are available. So essential oils are available in almost all plant parts. So for example, in roots, for example, vetiver. Then leaves, there are many plants which in which the leaves contain the aromatic components, for example, mint, tulsi, eucalyptus, etc. Then stem bark, the example is cinnamomum, sandalwood, agarwood, camphor, turpentine, etc. Then resins, example, dhoop, flowers, clove, or the stigmas, kesar, seed, nutmeg. So from different plant parts, the essential oil or the aroma compounds, they are available. Then we have to think this also, why the aroma compounds, they are produced by the plant. We have seen human being, why for they have used. They have used for many purposes. But we have to, being biologists, we should also pay to the attention. What is the role of these plant products they will play in the plants? So essential, all these aroma compounds, they are secondary metabolites, like other secondary metabolites, alkaloids, then tannins, etc. They are also secondary metabolites. And they are produced from mevalonic acid pathway. Now, what is this mevalonic acid pathway? Now, you know the basic pathways, pathway of production of fatty acids, the pathway of production, the sugar or glucose, or the pathway, how the amino acids they are formed. So they are the primary metabolites. They are how they are produced. You must have studied it in biochemistry. But there are also specific pathways for the secondary metabolite production. For example, several alkaloids, they are produced by the succinic acid pathway. Like that, say many of the secondary metabolites, they are produced from the mevalonic acid pathway. So this mevalonic acid pathway starts from acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA is a basic component from respiration. It is the initial precursor for the Krebs cycle. And it produces several organic acids. So the main precursor, what will be the substrate for this pathway, and that is called mevalonic acid pathway. And many of the secondary metabolites, for example, carotenoids are there, terpenoids are there, or the rubber, etc. Many of the complex compounds are formed from this mevalonic acid. From many of the growth regulator like abscisic acid or gibberellic acid are also formed from the mevalonic acid pathway. So this is very important pathway as far as the secondary metabolites are concerned. And all essential oils, they are formed from this mevalonic acid pathway. Then, as I have told you, we should think of why for these essential oils they are produced. So there are many roles, several roles they are played. And one of the major role is many of these compounds, they are produced and they show their highest production, highest peak at the time when plant will enter into the. So they are required to attract insects. So one of the role is to attract pollinators. Then the second role is they will be produced at the time of infection, when the plant will undergo some infection, antifungal or antibacterial. For that they will be produced. So they are produced sometimes as the defense system. And sometimes they are stress busters also. So when the plant will suffer with some stress, that may be water stress, that may be the temperature stress, at that time also these metabolites might be produced at the highest concentration. So like the other secondary metabolites, they will be the concentration or the production of the essential oils will be enhanced through the stress. So this is why and this is how the secondary metabolites, they will be produced in the plant, and these are the different roles they will be doing in plant metabolism. So I have told you these compounds are produced from the mevalonic acid pathway, and for all essential oils, for all aroma compounds, what is the basic compound? The basic compound is the 5-carbon compound that is called isoprene. So these are isoprene units. So from this 5-carbon compound, there will be, by coming together of these 5-carbon compounds, there will be the several terpenoids form. So all these essential, what is the basic brick of the essential oils? That is the terpenes. So these terpenoids, so when two of the molecules, they come together, two of the 5-carbon compounds come together, they will form monoterpenes. When three will come together, that will form sesquiterpenes. And four will come together, that will form the diterpenes. So there are various familiar compounds which are diterpenes, which are sesquiterpenes, and which are monoterpenes. So what are the example of monoterpenes? Citronellal, or linalool, or geraniol. That is extracted from oil, lemongrass, citronella, oil of citronella, that will have the monoterpene. And how will be the monoterpene? Monoterpene will be acyclic monoterpene. So these are acyclic monoterpenes. These are the examples of monocyclic ones. So monocyclic means they will have one benzene ring. So these are the examples. For example, terpilion or carbone, thymol, what is extracted from pinus. So these are the examples of monocyclic monoterpenes. Like that, there are different examples of 15 carbon. They are called sesquiterpenes. So farnesol, for example, is a sesquiterpene. So these are different examples of, so there are several examples. For example, santalum is diterpenoid. So there are sesquiterpenes or monoterpenes or diterpenes, vetiver, for example, that is sesquiterpene. So these are examples, or this is the chemistry of terpenoid compounds. So we have seen in which organs the essential oils are created, why four essential oils are created, and what is the chemistry of essential oil. Now we should see, we should go to the how to identify the best cologne. And before that, we should understand that quality of essential oil, that will be depending on several factors. For example, age of the plant, the climatic condition, the geographical location. Then there are some certain minor compounds also, they contribute in the quality of essential oil. So one by one, we will see the examples. So the first example is how age decides the quality of essential oil. As I have told you, one of the why essential oils they are produced is they are to attract the insects. So example is mint. Mint oil in toothpaste and many of the pharmaceutical preparations, it is used as the aroma compound. So mint or mentha piperata. So this mint, it is a popular thing, that the quality of mint oil will be enhanced at when the plant is in full bloom. And on what the quality of essential oil. So this mint oil, when we extract the mint oil and analyze that, so what we see is the essential oil will comprise of not only one single compound, it is a combination of many components, sometimes even 100 components where they will be contributing in the essential oil. So principal constituents of peppermint oil are menthol, about 30 to 55%, and menthone. So the ratio of menthol to menthone for the commercial purpose, or when the mint oil will be supposed to be of best quality, the ratio of menthol to menthone will be 2:1. So when this will be achieved, this ratio will be achieved when the plant will enter into the flowering phase. So when we should, what is the good time to extract the essential oil? When the plant will enter into the flowering stage. So always, being agronomist, we should keep in mind when the plant should be used for extraction of essential oil. So this is how age will affect the quality of essential oil. Then how geographical location will also determine the quality of essential oil. For this, I have taken the example of khas or vetiver. So there are two types of vetiver. So there are two different chemotypes, we can say. There are two different chemotypes of vetiver. North Indian vetiver, that is called khas oil. And in South India, what vetiver we get, that is called oil of vetiver. So what is the location of getting North Indian variety? The location is Haryana, Punjab, etc., Gujarat. So that is the location where we will get the North Indian variety. Then the characteristic feature of this North Indian variety is it is flowering. It is wild type. It is flowering. And the oil yield, the North Indian khas oil is regarded as precious essential oil. But its yield is very less. Can you see the yield is 0.28%? On the contrary, in South Indian variety, the yield is quite higher, 2.37% comparatively. But the quality of essential oil, when you consider the North Indian essential khas oil, will contribute its typical odor. How will be the odor? The aroma is described in many ways. So when you smell in the beginning, what type it will be, then after some time, after 10 minutes, after 15 minutes, how you feel that smell. This is called how the fragrance is described. So these are the different ways, and these are the different ways how the fragrance is described. So we are describing it as woody, earthy, sweet note. So this North Indian essential oil will be having unique earthy and sweet note. On the contrary, how will be the note of the essential of the South Indian essential oil? That will be harsh, woody and spicy. So this sweet and earthy is preferred. And why, which compounds they contribute to this sweet and earthy note? They are special compound. What are they? Eudesmin or eudesmin, sesquiterpenes like cusinol, cusisnol, etc. So these compounds, which are typically present in North Indian essential oil, North Indian vetiver oil, they will impart the different smell, different aroma to the North Indian essential oil. That will make it more valuable. So what are the regular components of this vetiver oil, this South Indian vetiver oil? That will have more vetivones and vetiverones and alcohols like vetiverol. So that will only contain vetiverol and vetivones. So because of that, so aldehyde and ketones and alcohols, and because of that, they will have only woody and spicy and harsh note. So there is a difference. So this is the example. This is the best example how geographical location also decides the different varieties. So these are some of the, apart from the chemical characteristics, morphologically also it differs. The morphology of root is concerned, also variable. Anatomically, so they are different. The difference between South Indian and North Indian variety. Sometimes, now one more example. This is not that when the contribution in the essential oil will be about 80% or 70%, at that time only they will contribute in the aroma. This is not that. Sometimes some compounds are present in very minor quantity, but then also they are the deciding factors of the fragrance. So the best example is rose oil. So these compounds, damascone, ionone, damasconone, all these compounds, they are present in very minor quantities, less than 1%, very less. But then also they are the major contributor of the aroma of the rose oil. Okay, so all these factors we should understand as an agronomist. All these factors we should understand, and taking in consideration with all factors, we should identify the best chemotype, the best clone for micropropagation of essential oil yielding plant. So these are the different factors that should consider when we are considering the tissue culture of the aromatic plants. So now actually we will start with the tissue culture of the aromatic plants. The subtitle given to that is Path from Lab to Land. So first we will see how the plants are brought in a in a lab, what treatments we have to give, and then how they are taken out of the lab and they are planted in the soil. So what is the path from lab to land? So that is the whole thing, what we call as the tissue culture of the plant species. Here we are considering tissue culture of the aromatic plants. Now, before we go in the details of the tissue culture, we should understand what is the difference between mass versus clonal propagation. Now, one of the attribute of the tissue culture is we have to propagate on high quantity, on large quantities of the same plant, that is called mass cultivation, mass propagation. So for mass propagation, we don't consider the clone. We take the explant from any of the plant, and that we use as the explant, and the tissue culture is done with that any of the explant, then this is called as mass cultivation. But when we do the clonal propagation, so micro propagation of desired clone is clonal propagation. So when we are going to identify the best clone, so this particular plant is having the specific aroma, this particular plant is having the particular minor component that is not present in any of the plant. So that case is called clonal, that is called clone. So desired clone. So propagation of the desired clone is called clonal propagation. For selection of desired clone, phenotypic characters, apart from phenotypic characters, what is also done is chemical fingerprinting and molecular fingerprinting. They are also used as the tools for finding out the best clone. So only the morphological characters, they are not enough. We should also take help of the chemical fingerprinting as well as molecular fingerprinting to find out the best clone. So for this, for how we will go for the finding out how we should make use of chemical and molecular fingerprinting in finding out the best clone. For that, I have taken the example of the propagation of Pelargonium graveolens, or that is also called rose-scented geranium. So propagation, tissue culture propagation of rose-scented geranium. So, okay. This work we have done in our laboratory. So this plant is called Pelargonium graveolens, or this is also called rose-scented geranium. So these leaves, if suppose we crush these leaves, how they will smell? They will smell like a rose. So this is called rose-scented geranium. Botanical terminology is Pelargonium graveolens. So there are three varieties in Kelkar company. There is a garden, huge garden, and they are having so many of the aromatic plant. They have the collection of their own many aromatic plants right from beginning. So they are having these three varieties. One is Bourbon, other is Egyptian, and the third is Reunion. So morphology, so one of the way to differentiate that particular variety is by the morphology. So how is the look, how is the phenotype of that particular plant, morphology?
Madam,
morphology. Hello? Hello?
Please continue, ma'am.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So suppose you consider morphology, the morphology of Bourbon and Egyptian, we can't differentiate. But reunion is different. So morphology wise, Bourbon and Egyptian is difficult to differentiate. So that's why, to be specific to the specific word, we will do help of the chemical fingerprinting. So this is nothing but the, to analyze the essential oil by the GC, gas liquid chromatography. So you can see this is how the peaks appear to be when we will inject the essential oil from the different varieties. It will give to the GC, gas liquid chromatography. This is nothing but the gas liquid chromatogram. So at different times, so when oil is injected at different times, it will be separated into the different fractions, into the different components. So at different times in the chromatogram, the different components, they will be separated. They are interpreted here as component 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And what are they? They are geraniol, citronellol, rose oxide, linalool, etc., apiudesmol, etc. So these components, they will be separated when we inject the essential oil to the gas liquid chromatography. It is nothing but the gas liquid chromatography, the different varieties of the different varieties of pelargonium. Now I have tabulated the important components. There are many components, but I have tabulated the major ones. So the three different varieties, they are Bourbon Egyptian. The third one is Kelker variety. So you can see how the different components, they are different. Suppose, see, in Egyptian, the third variety is Kelker, or it is also called reunion variety. Okay. So if you suppose pay the attention over the citronellol, amount of citronellol. So citronellol, what we need, which oil will be preferred? Suppose we are using that in the food, then what we prefer, that it should have the rosy note. And for that, what we don't want, this should be lesser. This citronellol will impart the citrusy note. And in Egyptian, can you see how much of the citronellol is there? Citronellol is much higher than the Bourbon and Egyptian. Okay. So what we want, the citronellol should be sir, and geraniol. You can see in Bourbon and reunion, the amount of geraniol is more. So that will contribute to the rosy note of the essential oil. Then the rose oxide is also present in Bourbon and reunion. And as I have told you, these are the two minor compounds. And these minor compounds, so you can see apiudesmol, how much small quantity it is there. And here it is nil. So apiudesmol is more in Egyptian, and it is not there in these two. So they are the deciding factor as far as the aroma is concerned. So this is how the different components, they contribute to the aroma. So this is called chemical fingerprinting. And what is used for chemical fingerprinting as far as the aroma chemistry is concerned, generally it is done by GC and GCMS. Now the another tool which surely differentiates the three different varieties, Egyptian, then Bourbon and reunion, they are the molecular fingerprints. So this is molecular fingerprinting is done, and there are specific bands. They are very specific to the reunion, or they are not present. So these bands, they are present in reunion, not present in Bourbon, and this band is not present in Egyptian. So this is how the molecular fingerprinting. So this band is present in reunion, not present in the Bourbon. So this is how the molecular fingerprinting also will help you to differentiate between the three varieties. So this is how we have differentiated ourselves with the different varieties. We are sure that this plant is of reunion, this plant is of Bourbon, and this plant is of reunion. We know these are the three different clones. And what we will go now, we will go for the clonal propagation or the tissue culture of that particular clone. Now, generally what is done is the nodal explant is used for the micropropagation or for the propagation of a clone. So what here also what we can use is the nodal explant. Why we use the nodal explant? So there are two alternatives. Sometimes we can use the apical bud, but apical bud chances means the probability is less. The nodal explant is the best explant material, and what it contains within the axil of the leaf, it will contain a bud, what is called axillary bud. So we get the initiation when we use the nodal explant, we get the initiation this bud. So this is the meristematic tissue. When we using the explant, what we should have some meristematic tissue. That meristematic tissue will grow, and that will propagate the shoots or the roots. So this is the concept. So when this nodal explant is used, you see this is the part of the leaf that we have excised, and here there was a bud, what is called as axillary bud. And we are interested in this axillary bud as the meristematic tissue. So this explant, we have given so many of the treatments. So before we use this, before we bring the explant from the garden, after that we have to give many treatments. We have to wash it with water. At that time we should add Tepol or Dettol to remove the dust particles and clean the explant and give the Bavistin like antifungal treatment. Then we have to bring the material, cut it in the desired sections, and bring the material in the laminar flow. And in the laminar flow also we have to treat the plant first with alcohol. Then we can use the mercuric chloride, or we can use the another fungicides and bactericidals elements, and we have to treat them. Then we have to wash it in water. So this is nothing but the sterilization treatment. And in the sterilization treatment, after giving the sterilization treatment, we have to wash it completely. And then this explant, we have to inoculate in the basal medium. Generally, which basal medium we have to use is the MS medium. For generally for the tissue culture, what media we use is called Murashik and Spoog medium. The components are fixed. When you search for the components of Murashik and Spoog medium, you will come to know there are macro elements, which there are micro elements, then there are micronutrients, then vitamins, etc. Iron also is there in specific quantity, and that composition per liter is given for the Murashik and Spoog medium. Okay, so this is the test tube, and that test tube is containing this Murashik and Spoog medium. So these are the different stages of the initiation. So what we are interested is this axillary bud should grow. So when we will transfer this explant in simply basal medium, what will happen? Only the axillary bud will enlengthen, will enlarge. But this is not the tissue culture. What we want, that this bud, this lateral bud or this axillary bud should be suppressed. And from the base of this axillary bud, there will be there should be the meristematic tissue developed, and from the meristematic tissue there are many small buds they should be arising. So this is called the tissue culture. Getting only one bud is not the tissue culture. That we can achieve in soil also. Suppose you keep this in water also, you will get it. This is not the purpose of plant tissue culture. Our purpose of plant tissue culture is we should have the multiple shoots. And what is the theory behind this? And because of this, we should add certain growth regulator to the basal medium, to the MS basal medium. So which growth regulator we should add, the theory behind we should understand. Now you know that when the plant has the apical meristem, and what is the characteristic, that apical meristem has inherent auxin there will be the auxin. And what is the characteristic feature of that auxin? The characteristic feature of that auxin is apical dominance. So what this auxin will do, there are different type of auxin, IAA, IBA, etc. Indol acetic acid, indol butyric acid, naphthalene acetic acid, etc. So these are the different artificial and natural auxins. So the auxin, natural auxin like indol acetic acid, will be present at the apex of the plant. And what is the role of the indol acetic acid or the auxin in that plant? That is apical dominance. What is the meaning of apical dominance? It will allow the apical meristem to grow, and because of that the height of the plant will increase. But what will happen when we excise the apex of the plant? We are excising the inherent amount of auxin. And because of that, what will happen? There will be enhancement in the lateral meristem. What will happen at that time? The lateral meristem will grow, and that will produce the side branches. So to allow the growth of side branches, what we should do is we should remove the character of apical dominance due to auxin. So when the auxin will be removed, what will happen? The lateral buds will be initiated. The lateral buds will start their function. Up to now, they are suppressed because of auxin. So the same thing we have to consider here. What we want, this bud we want to suppress. This bud is containing some amount of auxin, some amount of inherent auxin. And we should provide something in a medium that will suppress the inherent auxin. And that work will be done by the anti-auxin chemicals. What are they? They are called the another group of plant growth regulators. They are called cytokinins. There are different type of cytokinins. They are BAP. They are generally aminopurines, kinetin is there, benzyl aminopurine is there, BAP, kinetin, zeatin, what is extracted from maize, it's called zeatin. What is extracted from coconut water, that is called kinetin. And BAP is the commercial compound, is the artificial compound. So benzyl aminopurine. So they are the derivatives of aminopurines and they are called cytokinins. So what the cytokinins they will do? So what we have to do in the basal medium, we have to add cytokinin in this medium. And what this cytokinin will do, that will suppress the apical dominance of auxine, that will suppress the inherent auxine. And because of that, what will be done, that this bud will be suppressed. The growth of this bud will be suppressed. So you see that this bud, instead of looking slender, looking growing slenderly, what you will see that as you increase the concentration of cytokinin in a medium, sometimes we will use 0.5, sometimes we will use 1, and sometimes we will use 2 milligrams per liter of the cytokinin. At that time you will see, as we increase the concentration of auxine, what will happen to this bud? This bud will be seen thick, fleshy, and this is how this growth will be retarded. And from the base you can see the lot of greening, lot of enlargement of the mother plant. And from that, ultimately what will happen, this will take about one month at least. So this will be retarded, this bud will be retarded, and from the base you can see the mother plant is undergoing greening, it is undergoing dilation, and from that n number of side buds, they will be arising, extra axillary buds, they will be arising, and are capable of giving rise to the multiple shoots. Okay, so this is the theory behind the arising of the gating of the multiple shoots. So what is the first step of tissue culture? From the explant, we should get the multiple shoots. And what I am telling, so from this condition to achieve this condition, can you see many buds are seen, multiple shoots are seen. So this will not be the result. In 1 month in the same medium, you will not get the multiple shoots like this. But what is the next step? The next step is the subculture. What is the meaning of subculture? So here, what we'll see, this bud will be retarded, and from the base, there are arising many buds. 2-3 buds. So at that stage, after 1 month, so the subculturing has to be done every month. So every month you should prepare the same medium, MS medium, what is containing 1 or 2 milligrams of cytokinin. So the same medium you have to use, and you have to divide this explant and put it in the fresh medium. So what is the meaning of subculture? Not only to transfer this in the fresh medium, but you have to divide the explant, divide the multiple shoots, and they should be transferred in a fresh medium. So this is how you can achieve the multiple shoot stage. So the duration. So duration required for more the herbaceous is the plant, more lesser duration will be required for the multiple shoots to achieve. So within 3 to 4 months, this condition will be achieved in Pelargonium graveolens. So this is called multiple shoot stage. Okay. After we have the sufficient multiple shoots, so sufficient number of tubes are there which are in multiple shoot stage. At that time, what we will do, we have to reduce the amount of cytokinin in the basal medium. So what this is called elongation, this is called elongation stage. Okay. So in this elongation stage, what we have to do, we have to decrease the concentration of cytokinin. So previously, suppose for initiation, for multiple shoot purpose, suppose the best results we got in 2 BAP or 1.5 BAP, then we have to reduce the concentration to 0.2 BAP or 0.5 BAP. So with that, what will be achieved? These multiple shoots, which are of very minute size. So we have to separate these shoots and put it again in a fresh medium, what is containing lesser concentration of cytokinin, very less, 0.2 or 0.5 concentration milligram per liter of cytokinin. And later on, so this is called elongation. So in this, when we decrease the concentration of cytokinin, what will be achieved is elongation. And the second thing what will be achieved here is we are preparing the plant for rooting. Okay, so for rooting, for root initiation, what is required is rooting will not be achieved when there will be higher concentration of cytokinin. So again, the opposite roles of auxin and cytokinin. So I have told you the specific role of one of the specific character of auxin is apical dominance. So like that, the very peculiar character of auxin is the root enhancement. So auxin also contribute in achieving root. So any of the explants, suppose you keep in a higher concentration of auxin, you keep the leaf explant, you can keep the shoot explant, and then what will be achieved directly, suppose in the medium we keep the auxin, then what will be achieved is rooting. So what I mean to say, for suppose we have to get the initials, what we have to give in a medium, that is cytokinin. But when we want the root initial, at that time what we should add in a medium, that should be auxin. And please try to understand, there should not be inherent cytokinin. So when the inherent cytokinin is there, it will not allow the root to take place. Okay, so what will be achieved here, apart from elongation, what will be achieved is we are decreasing the concentration of cytokinin that will enhance the root induction. So that can occur in two ways. There are certain herbaceous species, they will induce rooting when we will decrease the concentration of cytokinin. In that medium only they will root. But sometimes for certain plants we have to add additional auxin, additional naphthalene acetic acid or indole butyric acid in this medium so that the plant will be rooted. So these are the various stages in which the from one segment of plant, n number of plants, this is called mass propagation. So these many plants will be separated and they will be rooted to achieve the mass propagation. Or this is, suppose it is a best clone, we will be achieving the mass propagation of the best clone, what is called clonal propagation. Okay, so next. So this I have explained to you already, the whole this thing. So this also I have explained the role of auxin and cytokinin in in vitro propagation. I have already explained. So for the shoot culture, we have to increase the, when we increase the concentration of cytokinin, we get the axillary buds. And when we increase the concentration of auxins, we get the rooting. So all this is graphically shown, diagrammatically shown in the auxin to cytokinin. So as we increase the concentration of auxin, you will see the root induction. As we increase the amount of cytokinin, you will get the shoot induction. And the intermediate stages, you will get the callus, that is undifferentiated cell mass. Okay. So this is the role of auxin and cytokinin in vitro propagation. Now we will go ahead. So as an example for clonal propagation, I have taken one of the example, that is the herbaceous plant, the Pelargonium graveolens. But what we feel very easy for the herbaceous plant is not that much easy in the tree species. So I should also deal with the tissue culture in tree species. So that is very different. What you have learned for MSc? For MSc, you must have taken very easy plant, herbaceous plant. They will be easier to cultivate and there will not be any hurdle in a plant tissue culture. But the reverse thing is experienced when we go for the plant tissue culture of the tree species. So what are the hurdles in cultivation? They are just the hard nuts to break, and particularly the tree species of Konkan area like mango and cashew nuts, they are really the hard nuts to break. Okay, so what hurdles we get in the propagation, in the tissue culture propagation of the tree species? The tree species, when we get the explant, there will be large amount of phenolics, and that will inhibit, that will make the plant recalcitrant for the shoot initiation. So because of phenolics, what will happen? Very less shoot initials. And the another characteristic is, even we get the shoots, they are difficult to root and they are very difficult to harden. So what I mean to say, that what principles, what practices we are applying for the tissue culture of herbaceous plant doesn't prove to be successful in the tissue culture of tree species. So I am taking one of the example of tissue culture of tree species, that is the spice plant. And on this plant, the name of this plant is Garcinia indica, very dear to me, because last 25 years on different aspects of Garcinia indica, I am working. And as this plant is dearer to me, my association with Dapoli is also dearer to me. Because for collection of the plant and for growing this plant, for several years I am coming to Dapoli. Right from, you may not be knowing Professor Karnik was in the horticulture department at that time. When I met him at that time also, he was very old person. So for his MSc, he has done his MSc on different floral types of Garcinia. So when Dr. Joshi, G.D. Joshi, was head of the Department of Horticulture, since then my association with the KKV is there, and the Dapoli and Konkan Krishi Vidyapeeth, they are the best moments of my life. And this is why I have taken this example. So Garcinia indica, one of the spice plant. This is regarded as spice plant. And I am sharing my experiences regarding the plant tissue culture of this spice plant. So I should not tell you all this, but when I go to north or when I go to another country, I have to explain how this plant looks to be and what are the different products of this plant. Why? Because this plant is very, very endemic, and it is found in only a small part of India. I can say only the few districts of the Western Ghats it is found, and it is our duty to protect this plant, to study this plant, to study the biochemistry and physiology and reproductive process of this plant, what is very unique with Garcinia, and it is our duty to keep it growing, to survive this plant is our duty, because we belong to this particular area where Garcinia indica belongs to, and that's why I have undertook the study of Garcinia. So it is not common, but look at it as narrowly endemic plant, and you know the economic importance of that plant. It will produce very attractive fruits, and when some person comes to you in summer, this is a welcome drink you offer. Then this is hydroxycitric acid what is extracted, then it is having it is from the seeds, it is producing the kokum butter that we are utilizing as far as the cosmetics are concerned, and this is amsul kokum. You know this, I should not explain these things. So when I go to some other country or some other places in India also, I have to explain all these things. People don't know this plant. Okay, so when I was very young, I have told you that for last 25 years I am doing tissue culture and all aspects of Garcinia. So I will like to share many experiences with this plant. So when I was very young, at that time in our college, we have started a very beautiful laboratory that is called Kelkar Education Trust Scientific Research Center. That was newly inaugurated. So this was, I'm telling, before say 25 years. So Mr. G.D. Kelkar was very much interested in propagating the aromatic and medicinal plants. And many of my colleagues at that time, Principal Paratkar sir was there, and he was sent to Lucknow for learning plant tissue culture. We had the scientific advisor, Dr. Hebre. He is well-known personality as far as the cell suspension cultures of very medicinally important products are concerned. He was expert. So at that time, I also, as my colleagues had learned the plant tissue culture, like that, I also wanted to learn the plant tissue culture. My number was the last number in the department. I was very young at that time. And I was newly married and I had a child of only 3 months. So I couldn't go anywhere to learn the technique. It was quite natural. Nobody will allow me to go to Lucknow and learn this technique. But when I have joined to this college, this V.G. Vazhe College, I told Dr. Hebre that I also want to learn plant tissue culture. So he started laughing and he asked me, Mrs. Devdhar, I am giving you the plant. What is native to your place? Because I belong to Ratnagiri. So that is native. That is native plant of you. So I am giving you kokum plant. Go for the plant tissue culture. So I was not knowing anything of plant tissue culture. Then I said, no, okay, I will start with the tissue culture of this plant. Then I started understanding. Then I started preparing the media, how to prepare the media. I started theory behind the growth regulators and whatnot. And I started working on the plant, on this plant. And this was really the good time for me, because when I have collected the plant, when I have collected the explant, then which explant material I should use, because Dr. Hebe was very expert as far as the plant tissue culture, cell cultures are concerned. So which explant I will use? So I went to Ratnagiri and I have brought the different type of explants. And when I have visited, luckily that was somewhere in January, February. So I got very immature, with the fruit size of only small lemons fruits were, or even smaller than that. So this fruit size was there. So along with the nodal explant, apical explant, I have collected that also and brought there. So what he told me, you first try this immature seed explant. So that was the first experienced guru. So he told me, instead of using the different other explants, you try first with the immature seed explant. So this was the first lesson from the guru. What was that? That when we are using the tree species, what we need, which explant we should use, that should be very immature. And what is for mass propagation, what will be the best explant? That will be the seed explant. So this is how from the seed explant, we have got the multiple shoots. Then this is how they are grown. And we have got the rooting also. And we have hardened these plants also. So we have, so one of the, I took one student for MSc. I was not recognized to take PhD students. So first student what I took, Manik Sambus is the name, I took for MSc, and he did this work. And then we have hardened this plant, and we have published a paper only of hardening of the tree species, hardening of the plant, Garcinia indica. So only on this we have published a paper on Garcinia, on micropropagation and rooting of Garcinia. Two separate papers were there. So only on rooting we published one paper. Okay, so this is how we have, one more thing. So I have not told anything about the hardening. So as we are learning the different steps in plant tissue culture, we should know this. So now, after getting rooting, what process, what we follow is the acclimatization. Okay. So how the acclimatization is done? So in acclimatization, we have to remove the rooted plant from the test tube. Now, two things are happening here. We were doing the tissue culture where the two things were maintained. The humidity was maintained and the temperature also was quite low. So suppose we transfer the rooted plant directly in the pot, what will happen? The chances are there that it will die. So we have to acclimatize the plant in a soil, the rooted plant in a tissue from the tissue culture laboratory. To acclimatize, there are several steps of acclimatization, what is called acclimatization or hardening also. So different components I took here for particularly Garcinia. I took cocopeat. I took cocopeat to sand in specific proportion, and cocopeat, sand and soil in specific proportion. So various mixtures we have to try. And then you have to first take the rooting mixture and you have to sterile it. And that sterilized rooting mixture, you have to take out the rooted plant, wash it thoroughly. There should not be any dot of the agar containing sucrose. Otherwise, what will happen? That will be contaminated. So you have to wash it thoroughly, and then you have to plant it in a sterile medium. And you have to cover this plant with the polythene, so that the humidity will be maintained, and you have to keep this plant in a hardening room where the temperature and the moisture is maintained. So you have to keep this plant in a greenhouse or in the special hardening room where the temperature and the moisture content will be maintained properly. And again, you have to cover this with a polythene bag. You don't have to. So there is water in the artificial water for some days, 8 to 10 days. You need not give any water because we are using foggers, we are maintaining the temperature, etc. So after say 10 days, what we should do, we should perforate the bag. After 15 days, we should remove the bag, and then this is called hardening. Then what will happen after removing the bag also, we have to maintain these plants again in a greenhouse. And after some time, again, when the rooting will be established, at that time, we can bring that plant out. Out of greenhouse. So there also we can keep it in a net shed, and after for some duration, some days, we can keep in a net shed. And then so all these things are called hardening or acclimatization. And now you can see how were the roots, particularly in the tree species, or is very important. We don't get the typical taproot system because the roots, they are not taproots here. So this is how the roots were in the beginning, and in the process of acclimatization, so how there were the lateral root initiation, how they were converted into the lateral roots, and different branches were there. So in the process of hardening, at that time, Dr. Hebre was in the task force of DBT, Department of Biotechnology. He was in the task force of tissue culture of aromatic and medicinal plants. There is a separate task force, and he was the member of the task force at that time. So at that time, what the project, they used to give lot of money to the people from BRC or the renowned organization. And what used to happen, they used to go to some foreign universities and not paid any attention to the project, what is given, what is funded by the Department of Biotechnology. So he had suggested that you give the project to the undergraduate teacher who is teaching undergraduate class, and I will show you how they work. And for this, for showing this, he suggested that you write a project to Department of Biotechnology. So this is how he helped me. I was not knowing how to present a project there, how to write the project proposal. I was very new at that time. I was very raw at that time. And then I have written a project proposal, and that was sanctioned, saying that even the undergraduate teachers work well. And that project proposal was based on the clonal propagation, because I have shown the micropropagation is possible. So we will choose a strain, elite strain, what is early fruiting. So we have noted one plant. One plant was suggested from that KKV. There is a garden, Garcinia garden. There are many, more than 20 plants are there. Plantation of near that Priyadarshini building, that plantation is there. So we have identified one plant, what is early fruiting, means that even fruits very February monthly fruits. So that we have chosen as a clone, best clone. So early fruiting was the criteria and high amount of hydroxycitric acid. They were the two criteria, and on that grounds, that clone we have selected, and we have started with the funds of DBT. We have started tissue culture propagation of the Garcinia. Okay, so for Garcinia, for clonal propagation, we were using the meristematic tissue from the 25 year old clone. That was a tree species, at least 25 years. So when we use this as a explant, it was not giving multiple shoots. So even though we subculture it several times, this I have experienced, this was not growing. The multiple shoot content were not achieved. We never had the problem of phenolics, but we had the problem of multiple shoots. So at that time, I have attended one conference, and in that conference, I listened to a person who had done lot of work on the tree species from Rajasthan. So I have talked, Dr. Shekhawat is his name. He was in Jodhpur, from Jodhpur University, and he suggested me that instead of MS medium, you try WPM medium. Lloyd and McConkie's WPM medium instead of the MS medium, and that will work, and that really worked. So from this condition, we came across this condition. Now one more. So we were successful in multiple shoot stage. So one more thing I want to contribute here when we work with the tree species. So the selection of, or the choosing the explant, seasonal variation is also, season is also important in choosing the explant. This is very important as far as the tree species are concerned. So we were collecting the explant in different, at least once in a month. So in different seasons, we were collecting the explants and we were doing the tissue culture. So what you can see here, when the explant is used in between June to September in monsoon season, we have got good response. So white bar shows response. Response means shoot initiation. So response is good. But being monsoon, the rate of contamination is very, very high. So response is good, but rate of contamination is very high. After monsoon period, for Garcinia species, you can see between October to January, at that time, even though the contamination was lesser, the response was also less. Only 50 to 60% of the plants used to give the shoot initials. So response was also less in winter season. And what we have seen, lot of differences there. When we have collected the plants in summer, you can see in summer, lot many initials before fruiting, lot many shoot initials, they come in this particular tree species. So particularly for the tree species, we have to we have to choose the explant when the tree species is on its own giving the new initials, when the plant is sprouting. And you know, when generally the tree species, they sprout in summer season. So is a best season for shoot initiation, very less contamination and very beautiful shoot initiation we got in between. So what we call as Vasanta Rutu, February, March, Vasanta Rutu. So in spring season, there would be very good response of shoot initiation. So what we see in a natural conditions, in a natural habitat is also true, even we do it in vitro. The same thing we experience in the in vitro conditions also. So this is very interesting result we got, and that I wanted to share with you. So this is how we got the multiple shoots in WPM medium. But unfortunately, we have not got the rooting. Are very difficult to and to get rooting. So we wanted to complete the project. It was getting completed. So we have tried. So this work was done by my another student, Meera Chabukswar, and she was very expert. So as I was introduced for tissue culture, technical hands, green hands are needed. So she was literally like that. And she had done grafting, in vitro grafting of the clonal explant. So this is how the grafting experiment, in vitro grafting experiment was successful. But side by side, we have changed the explant totally. And we have taken the root sucker explant. So we have taken this explant. You know that Garcinia particularly has the habit to produce the root sucker. And beautiful regeneration we got. So that is the clonal propagation also from the clone, from the base clone. We have used the root sucker as the explant. This is how we were successful in the regeneration, in the clonal propagation. So using different explants, we have the experience. So this work was done by one of my another student, Rashmi Tembe. She has done both the things she has done. She has done the micropropagation of new two plants, one herbaceous plant, that is Pelargonia. So she has done this work. So these are hardened plant with root suckers. Now, side by side, we have also chosen the plants from the different species, different genera belonging to the same family, Clusiaceae, and many of the genera, they were endemic. For example, Mamia suringus, we have chosen. One of my students, I have given the tissue cultures of these two plants, Mesua fera and Mamia suriga. So Mamia suriga, belonging to the Clusiaceae, is also endemic to the Western Ghat. So that is the reason why we have chosen that plant. And we have also established a protocol for both these species, Mamia suriga and Mesua fera. For these plants, successful protocol has been standardized. So side by side, we have also established this work was done by one of my students, Nilesh Jadhav, and side by side, how the protocol to establish the extraction of essential oils from these two plants, because these both of these plants, they produce very fragrant flowers. So the Mesua fera, in Marathi we call it as Nag Chafa, very fragrant flowers, and Mamia suriga is really a gem of flowers, that is Surangi. So for both these things, we have established a protocol for extraction of essential oils. And what we thought that for Mamia suriga, it is a well-known plant. So the extraction of essential oil must have been documented, but that was not the case. And we have tried for several days, but we were having the difficulty of extraction. And what we have realized with when I was going somewhere, I went to one shop and there I got the oil of surangi. So I was very happy, and I purchased that bottle. And when I smelled that, it was not literally smelling like Mamia. And then I have realized that this extraction protocol is not at all standardized, because the plant is endemic, that is not familiar, not found in all locations, but it will be found in very specific locations, particularly in the Western Ghats. Only this Mamia suriga is found, even that will flower profusely in one particular month only. And that's why this protocol was not standardized. We have even the difficulty in standardizing the protocol, but we took the help of Kanoj is very popular for this, and there is the organization, National Organization for Fragrance and Flavor Development Center at Kanoj, and they take the workshops, and there they establish the protocols for these particular essential. So I have written that I am working on so and so plant, and I am getting the difficulty. So the director at that time in this organization, he has directed me to carry out to standardize a protocol. And then we were successful in extracting in cold maceration in hexane and salicylate extraction even in hexane. So hexane was the most effective solvent. So solvent extraction was successful. And as I have told you that most of the essential oils, they will be analyzed by GC, but there is also the additional specific analyzing process, what is called head space analysis. What is head space analysis? There will be the closed glass container, and in this glass container we have to keep the sample. So we have collected from Dapoli. You know that in KKV there is a row of surangi plants, and in particular season that will be profusely flowering. So we collected these plants. Immediately he came to Mumbai and he has given it to the head space analysis. So there will be a closed glass chamber, and we have to keep the material in the glass chamber, and directly that will be analyzed for the constituents. So a really very beautiful analytical procedure that is called head space analysis. And whatever components they are present in the flower, directly they come in this analysis. So what I wanted to show you, in the head space analysis, these compounds were there, and the same compounds, they are detected in the hexane in both maceration also and salicylate extraction also. So we were quite successful in having the same component what were detected in the head space, and the fragrance in this extraction was very similar to that of Mamia. So we were successful in standardizing the extraction procedure, and then we have utilized that in a cream, body cream, massage oil and hair oil. So we have prepared, that student have prepared the product, and this was this paper was published, extraction and evaporation in product, so International Journal of Pharmacy and Pharmaceutical Science. So best journal, one of the best journal, this was published. And we had a lot of queries afterwards also of this extraction protocol. And for this, that was a very good experience to talk with the farmers and whatnot. So this work was done with our teacher. We had a very beautiful program of PGDPCM, postgraduate diploma course in aromatic and cosmetology. So that time the head was Renuka Thergaukar, and with her we have done this. And Nilesh, who has done this job, he was totally taken by her. She has one company, Global International. And in that company he is working now. So these are some of the experiences with clonal propagation of the aromatic plants. So contributors, I have already told you, for clonal propagation, Rashmi Tembe, mass propagation from the seed explant, Manik Sambus, clonal propagation of Garcinia with root suckers and in vitro grafting, Dr. Meera Chabukswar, and Mesua Suriga, Mamiya Suriga, Dr. Nilesh Jadhav. These are the contributors of this work. Only I have compiled our experiences and presented this presentation. So thank you for allowing me to talk and share the experiences with you. Now the platform is yours. You can ask, if suppose you have to ask me something, you can ask me. Yes.
So, madam, first I will appreciate your efforts. It was not only scientific, but it was colorful, it was artistic, and furthermore, it was having the essence. So, we have enjoyed, I think the mass also would have enjoyed the this thing. And I will say that the session is now open for the interaction or the questions. If the students have any questions, they can pose. And you can directly ask. Yes, any question from student side?
Yes, you can ask any language, in any language, in Marathi also you can ask.
You can ask in Marathi, Hindi, English, whatever it may be.
Hello, ma'am. Dhanashri here.
Yeah.
Ma'am, can you give a commercialized outlook of this essential oil production or essential oil cultivation by farmers?
You want plant or essential? I will give you both, because we have standardized the protocols for clones, best clones also, and for extraction process also. So after standardizing the protocol from Mia Suriga, we have got many from farmers. Many phone calls I received, and they were really interested in having this extraction process on a large scale. So this, anybody, if somebody wishes, they can take up. And Renuka is there, and even Nilesh is doing the same work, and he belongs to same Konkan area. So definitely, if you want to establish this, somebody wants to be the antarbhuta, this is the best thing to do.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for
even in chat box, madam, there are some questions. One is for BBC 135. How many hardening techniques are there? Somebody has asked. I am audible?
Yes, sir. Generally, we follow what I have explained. The same technique we follow. So acclimatize in the soil, sand, soil, cocopeat, whatever is giving you response. That depends on plant, how the plant is. So sometimes soil is preferable, sometimes soil sand is preferable. So you can go for greenhouse, you can harden in net shed. So that depends on the how the plant will react, will respond. And how much hardy is a plant.
But
generally the process is same. Generally the process is same. Acclimatization process is same. Sometimes you can skip the greenhouse and go to the net shed directly.
One question is from my side is that during the means the handling with the kokum, Garcinia indica, you're told that the different seasons they may make impact on the your result. And in that you're told that in the February to May, if you collect the plants, that will give the reaction. But ma'am, my experience is different, that during that particular period, the content of the phenol is very high. Because as the temperature elevates, this electrolytes as well as the phenolics, they elevates. So how to deal, whether or deal with that in some different mode or way?
See, fortunately in Garcinia, we never have problem. We were hurdled by phenolic. That may be the reason for getting good response. Phenolic was not hurdled in Garcinia. That may be some other tree species. Phenolic content may be oozed out. But that was not the case with Garcinia.
So whether you would like to disclose the treatment, how your...
No. We didn't give any treatment. Treatment was not necessary only. Only we have inoculated the plant. We have not given any citrate, ascorbic acid or phenolics, nothing with activated charcoal, nothing we have. Just WPM medium, in that we have inoculated.
Yes, anybody else?
Namaste ma'am, this is Hanumant. I have a question, just same related to the question asked by Dr. Deshpande sir. You found the seasonal variation. Did you find the same seasonal variation in Garcinia in case of root suckers?
Root sucker, there is specific season in which we get the root suckers. And the amount of root suckers in male and female plants also is different. Generally, the root suckers are found more in male plant, and there are very less female plants where we get the root suckers. So there is a specific season in which where we get the root suckers.
Okay, now. And same question, actually in Garcinia, we have a male-female problem. So can you give any... way out through tissue culture to tackle this problem?
You select the root sucker from the female plant and then you will get the clonal based for Garcinia female.
Suppose if we use the immature seeds of female plant, is there chance of getting a male plant out of the tissue culture plants?
Yes, definitely. Because Garcinia has apomixis. So you will suppose the plant, the seed is result of apomixis, then many of the plants will be female plants. But if it is a result of sexual reproduction, then there will be the combination of female, bisexual and the male plants. So that depends how the seed is derived, whether it is apomictic or whether it is sexual. Garcinia is very interesting.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, any more question from student side? There is no question. I will say that the session is over. And once again, I am very much thankful to Dr. Mrs. Devdar. So the lecture was really colorful. It was and it was just a job of fine fingers. It was really experience, ma'am, to listen from the horse's mouth. By the from your lecture, we could come to know that really it is a tissue culture is an art rather than science, art and very artistic work we could see from today's your lecture. And I think students must have grasped that essence.
thank you, sir.
Yeah.
And I want to specially thank to KKV because many times we have visited to collect the material. And this is the first time, whatever we have worked with the same explant, this is the first time I am presenting. So at the end of my career, at least I had a chance to present what I did with that explant. Thank you. So I am very much thankful to you give me a chance to present what I did with that material. And this was a nice journey working in Dapoli. And all of my husband, my children, they are in love with Dapoli. We like Dapoli.
There is a red hand, I think. Ms. Dhanasri Matre, she want to ask.
Yes.
Ms. Dhanasri Matre, she want to ask.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Ma'am, one more question. Like essential oils, whichever you mentioned here, but there are also a range of different essential oils like tea tree oil, which is mostly used in cosmetics for facials and many other different products. So we can do work on those plants also in plant tissue culture?
But the tea tree, the material should be available. No, that is not Indian plant. So what I will suggest you, Western Ghats is the big collection of aromatic and medicinal plants. Why you are going for these plants? So this is what I have experienced. I am working with lot of cosmetics. And don't go for the international herbals, international actives which are utilized. We in Western Ghats are enriched with these herbal compounds. What is essential is to find out what are their applications. So what I will recommend that instead of working on foreign herbals, you concentrate yourself to what we are getting in Western Ghats. You will get lot of things there. This is my experience of 40 years that I will recommend you.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for the advice.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
I'm Tushar Gazre.
Yeah.
I had a few questions regarding the Garcinia. But before that, with the permission of Savadikar, sir, I would like to thank you because I personally was very eager to listen to you since many days. Because I even work on Garcinia indica also. So it is very difficult to get guidance from people like you, because you people like Savadikar sir, you are like living legends that keep guiding in this. We are really very thankful to you to have you as a speaker today.
Thank you. Hello, and ma'am. If you want to talk with me personally also, at any time. Available.
Ma'am,
so my question was regarding Garcinia indica.
What?
So my question was regarding Garcinia indica. Hello. So when we achieve the tissue culture, so are there any observations observed in male and female when we raise the tissue culture plants like of kokum in vitro, like vigor or etc.?
No, male and female plants, as far as the response is concerned, same response. Male and
female. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. And my email ID is with Savardekar, sir.
I think everybody must have been satisfied with the queries or the doubts which you are having in your mind for so many days. Madam, once again, I'm thankful. Now I declare that the session is over. And being organizing secretary, it is my duty once again to thank all the participants as well as the today's orator. And I declare that the session is over. Thank you.
Thank you, Deshpande sir. Thank you.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Yeah.